Hello, how you doing? I pray you're well. Been praying for you. I pray that everything that we have sought to try to share with you out of God's word, that it has helped to open God's word and open your eyes that you will see, understand, and that you will walk in, that you will live out the truth of it.
Yeah.
Let me quickly whisper a word of prayer. We're still in 1 John chapter 2. We're going to work our way through verse 12 through to verse 17. But I'm going to kind of quickly go back from verse 7 to 11 so that we can just kind of caboose, pick this up, join it, so that we can see exactly what is going on. Even now, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
1 John chapter 2. That small letter, we've been working our way through it. Last week, we were seeking to examine, explore, and explain verses 7 through verse 11. And John doesn't mince words. John is not worried about whether folk like it or agree with it. Truth is truth, no matter what side of the street it walks on. John has been making it clear in helping us to see what we say as opposed to what we do. What we say as opposed to how we really feel. And he has been saying to the believer, to the Christian, it's not enough to talk and your life is in conflict, contradiction, that it doesn't measure up. It wouldn't measure up for me to tell Sis Pearson that I have a Ferrari at the house and she is so excited about all that I have said about it until the garage door will go up and there's a tricycle with a license plate that said Ferrari. Because I put a license plate on a tricycle, don't turn it into a Ferrari. Just for anybody to say that they are Christian, but their life is so raggedy, so out of kilter, that even that, like oil and water, it don't even mix. Yeah. Now understand that all of us in here, even you, who I can't see, though we have some struggle, there's a difference between struggling and being stuck. Yeah. And yet, John is making it clear. He is saying that if we've got fellowship with the Father, if we've got ongoing relationship with the Father, that we can have an ongoing relationship with the Father and purposely, intentionally, this ain't no accident, this ain't a matter, well, I'm just human, and then we live raggedy lives. He is saying that you can't be that close to holiness and godliness and yet purposefully live in darkness. He says, your claim, which then ends up in a contradiction, has one conclusion, and he says that it's a lie. I don't know about you, but I want to make sure that I'm living as best as I can by God's word. Because I'm not only affecting, but I'm infecting somebody. Yeah. You say, well, you're a preacher. Well, let me tell you, you're a Christian. Okay? So you don't get off, you know, hey, don't go to the preacher thing.
Yeah.
Well, you the reverend, and you're supposed to be, well, wait, who are you?
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. If you say you're a Christian, you've got as much responsibility.
Yes.
Okay. You didn't know that? Christ-like. That's what the word Christian means. Now don't go back and I'm going, oh, I ain't gonna do the Jesus thing no more. Well, no, you better stay with us. Don't get off that. Stay there.
Yeah.
You and I are under a microscope and a telescope. There's always somebody looking at us up close and somebody looking at us at a distance.
Yeah.
Looking at us not to mirror and to mimic us, but meaning in order to find out what's wrong. And then say, I thought you were a Christian.
Yes.
Well, we got to move the text. Because John says some very important things in verse 12 through verse number 17. And it's amazing the language that he uses. Look at your lesson, if you will. John, in the following verses, verses 12, 13, and 14, he voices some very strong warnings to his reader. And while this is a general letter, it goes to everyone to whom it's written, he identifies and he mentions, it's amazing when you look at the people that he identifies here, that there are actually three types of Christians that he's really talking about, okay? Mm-hmm. In every church, let me have your attention, there are at least three types of believers. John using little children, young man, or father. These are metaphors. These are words that represent a type of believer. Yeah. Not literal little kids, middle-aged folk, and old folk. You got to understand where he's going with all of this.
Yeah.
Okay? And because the first thing that jumps out of the passage is that there's a sequence here. Little children, you see it?
Yes.
Young men and fathers. No group is left out. No group is overlooked. Let me have your attention. Let me share something with you real quick. No matter how old someone may be that attends church or is a member of a church, no matter how long they've been a member of that congregation, no matter how long they've been going to church, are y'all with me?
Oh, yes.
Although those things are great, there's a warning. None of them determine how spiritually mature a person is.
Amen.
It would be great. Somebody says, well, I've been a Christian for 30 years. When I've been a member of a church for X amount of years, that is no guarantee that as long as they say they've been a Christian, it does not say that they're not still on spiritual infamil.
Mm-hmm.
Paul says, when I was a child, I thought I was a child. He said, but when I became grown up, I put childish stuff away. Hello?
Yes, sir.
I think it would really be ridiculous if I were to pass out rattlers, you know, I ain't talking about snakes. I'm talking about, you know, them little things that the babies have. And after a while, they think, oh, that's so cute, you know. But wait a minute. All of us in here numerically are well beyond the age of being caught with a rattler in our hand. Hello. We who have been with Jesus long enough, there are some things we ought to be well beyond now. Oh, it didn't get a whole lot of amens. There's a difference between physical maturity, spiritual maturity.
Yes.
John is not talking about physical maturity, though there are age groups in the church. But age groups in the church do not define or determine how spiritually grown up some people are. You can find out in just a matter of minutes how grown up some of the saints are.
Amen.
And you can find out in a matter of some minutes how spiritually needed for maturity there is.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep. And let me say this. Please don't make the error of saying everybody in a church is like a couple of folk. A couple of people don't determine what a whole congregation of people are. And yet, John identifies. He says, there are different groups. God who gave us spiritual life in Christ intends for that life to grow, and he intends for that life to grow into maturity. Let me have your attention real quick. Do I have any mamas in the house? Raise y'all's hand. Okay. If you're a mama, you had a child, right? Your turtle might be your baby, but you didn't birth it. Okay, let's be real. You had a baby?
Yes.
I think they got a little age on them now.
Yeah,
by now they ought to be.
Yeah.
You ain't about to be bottle feeding no 25-year-old now.
No.
I hope not.
Yeah.
You expect to see, based on the care, the nurture, and what you feed it, to see growth takes place. Come here. Let's talk about you and me, not about these babies we brought in the world. Are we still in spiritual pampers? Are we growing? And you know what? Our spiritual maturity ought to not just be seen by others, but we ought to see it ourselves. Not that it use it as a platform for bragging rights, but the fact of the matter is, we ought to be able to see that we're getting stronger, not just in the Word of God, but our conduct ought to be changing. There's some things now, our appetites ought not be what they used to be for. Spiritual growth is a privilege, but it is also an obligation. God expects me and you to grow. We are responsible for growing. And the goal of spiritual development, guess what? The bottom line is that we become more like the Lord. That's who you aiming to be like. I pray you're aiming to be like him. We know it because that's what the Bible tells us. And the more we walk according to the aid of the Holy Spirit, and walking in the Spirit means walking with the aid of him, listening to him, obeying him. Our obedience to the Word of God under the guidance and the control of the Holy Spirit means that we can expect to see growth takes place. Well, let's look at verse number 12 real quick. I'm writing to you, little children, because your sins have been forgiven for his name's sake. John begins the verse and several others, especially in verse 13 and 14, announcing why he's writing to them and who he's writing to. He says, I'm writing to you. You see that? Then he says again, I'm writing to you. You see that? But then he also says, I've written to you. And it's amazing. He doesn't miss anybody, does he? Every group is mentioned. Every group is addressed. And so nobody can say, well, you left me out. All of us are in here. Every group is named, identified, spoken of. And watch this. In spiritual maturity terms, not physical age. Stop for a second. Let me have your attention. Which category do all of us individually fall in? Still spiritual immature, still a baby. Growing, second one. Or we are really leveling at a place of maturity. We listen, y'all. You in one of them. We're in one of them. And how we live reflects whether we are spiritually immature, like a little kid, or whether we are growing. And you don't grow just because you ask for it.
No.
You go through to get to it. How do you think your prayer life got where it is? You had some stuff come. You had some storms show up. You had some setbacks occur. You had some dark days. I just need about five folk that ain't got no problems talking to me. You have had some things that were well beyond your control, and you trusted the Lord to do only what the Lord could do. Your prayer life has gotten stronger. It ain't a matter of adding more vocabulary to it because it sounds good. No. Been through some stuff. And so I know who I'm talking to, but I also know what I'm talking about when I talk to him. Understand that this matter of little children, he's talking about the born again ones. And every born again believer begins in spiritual infancy. All of us who have grown in the Lord, have gotten stronger, have grown up, have matured, we all started somewhere. Just like, I remember, maybe just come thank you, Lord. It's amazing how I'm, in a moment the Lord can bring some stuff back to you, to your mind. I remember my oldest brother asked my mother one day. He was old enough to know better, but he asked her anyway. Mama, did I come out this big? She said, "Do you think I birth horses?" No. Let me say this. Here's where we are called upon, those of us that have a level of spiritual maturity, to be patient with folk who are not as mature in Christ as we are. Ain't place to go beat them upside the head and drive them away. Remember where you were and where you might still be. You and I have not conquered every Mount Everest in our lives. Some of us are still struggling with, hello? Come on. Some of us are still overcoming. Some of us are moving at a better place and a better pace. But everybody is not where you are. And to have an expectation that might be very unrealistic, well, you've been going to church all these years, okay, come and sit in a building, does not mean folk been growing up. Hello? You been reading about, some folks have just been reading, but they have not been applying the word of God. Amen. Some of us are just now catching on. He says, your sins are forgiven. That's important for newborn believers to understand that you are rescued from sin by an all-powerful God through Jesus Christ. And this is key, and it's biblical, that every believer needs to know and understand this. We're not saved by works. We're not saved by what we do. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 says it's only by grace and unmerited favor of God on our behalf. But understand, because they are saved, they got some growing to do.
Yeah.
Let me ask this question while we're just talking. How many of us in here have already graduated from the Bible? I'm glad I had to bring that one in. Yeah. How many of us have maxed out in our growth as a believer? Now raise your hand. None of us. You said, preacher, you ain't honored. No, I'm still growing too. Still striving. Still wanting to be close and better. And my prayer is that this is not just some Sunday morning mood matter. This is a daily life pursuit.
Yes.
Y'all miss that? Every day we've got an opportunity to be better for him than we were on yesterday.
Yes.
Question is, do we want it?
Yes.
But then look at verse number 13. Verse 13, real quickly. I'm writing to you fathers, because you know him who has been from the beginning. Stop right there. The second group of mature people that John writes to or identifies, he calls them fathers. John starts the verse that should be in similar fashion as he does previous, and he says something that takes the fathers back to a dateless, timeless past, a moment he calls the beginning. John has been known to be talking about in the beginning. John chapter 1 verse 1. Same author here that writes this.
Yeah.
These mature believers know the Father. And this brings to mind Christ's teaching in John chapter 14 verse 6, where he says that he is the way, truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by way of me.
Yeah.
And those who know the Father are those who have come to faith in Christ, and our sins have been forgiven.
Yeah.
You can't know God the Father without knowing the Son. And if you know the Son on a relational basis, that means that you have trusted him by faith to rescue you from sin. The fathers are more mature and experienced believers. Let me stop right there. I believe in every congregation, God has mature people in the body to help others that may not be there to know that they got promise and possibility. Yeah. Yeah. It's not that it's some badge of courage. It's not that we, oh, well, I'm, no, it ain't about being better. No, 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 no. It's not that we are greater than somebody else. No, no. Here it is. If a brother be overtaken in a fault, you that are controlled by the Holy Spirit, restore such a one in the attitude of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. That matter of restore is a medical term that speaks about where bone got broke. And anybody in here ever had a broke arm? All right. How about when the doctor came to examine, he said, hey, how you doing? Lift it up. Something's going to come out and it ain't a thank you, Jesus. Can we talk? The expectation is because you know it's broke and you're in a place of knowledge that I don't have, I'm expecting you to handle me gently and gingerly because you know I'm in pain. But then also place it right. Because if you place it wrong, it's going to grow back. And it grows back wrong, it means it might need to be broke again.
Yes.
Said a whole lot without having to say a whole lot. We that are strong in the word and mature ought to be able to help those that need proper biblical guidance in the word. We know we've gone through. Our experiences are not just for us. We ought to be helping others, even in our own families.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah.
People that we go to worship with.
Yeah.
It ain't a matter we got some S on our chest.
No.
It's because by the grace of God that we've been able to not just go through, but to learn some things. And so here it is, mature. They know the Lord. They know him in a very personal way. They've got fellowship with him. Okay? They've been taught. They have taken the word serious. They've applied it to their lives. Hello? And they are growing. I have a simple, but yet a very strong statement. You might want to write this down. How many of y'all got pencil in your hand? Any of y'all writing already? Information. That word, information. After you write that at the end, do a plus sign. Application. That's the next word. And then have an equal sign at the end of application. Growth. Simple, but yet real. If I take information, that's the first thing. If I take God's word, plus application, if I apply it to my life, if I live out the truth of it, I can expect to grow. You got it?
Yes.
If you want to talk about growing spiritually, it ain't coming UPS. It ain't coming electronically. You have got to trust what God said. Live in accordance to what God's word said. Because if you live in accordance to what God's word said, then you will see that there are some things that once fit you, now don't. Don't want to live like that. Don't want to think like that. Don't want to do those things. Don't want to go to those places. Because when I realize what pleases God helps me, then I grow. And I keep growing. And I want to tell you that there is no ceiling on your growth. Question is, how bad do you want it? How important is it to you? But then look at verse number 14. Look at what he says in verse number 14. I've written to you, fathers, because you know him who has been from the beginning. I've written to you, young men, because you're strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. He again addresses fathers as he did in verse number 13, but he's repeating his comments that they know the Lord.
Yeah.
Wow. This is not just head knowledge. This is life relationship.
Yeah.
And finally, he provides a second word toward the young men. Here again, he mentions both their overcoming of evil as well as their strength. And I'm glad that in the original language, the way that it's written is that it's a matter of doing and being, not that they just arrive and they don't have to worry about it. All of us in here are going to have to deal with the devil.
Yeah.
The reference to strength is not about muscles, but our spiritual growth. And it's in these believers that the word of God was, watch this, remaining and abiding. Okay?
Yeah.
You know why that's critical? What do you have to draw on if the word of God is not in you? Not much or anything at all. You're left to your own persuasion, your own superstition, your own thought process. Your word have I hid in my heart. And he's not talking about the left side of our chest. He's talking about within himself. That I may not sin against you. Like the deer pants for the water brook. I have that intense desire for you and for your word. Yeah. Anybody in here can remember a time when the Holy Spirit spoke to you and took you to the word of God about a matter, and the only reason why he could take you back to the word of God is because you had the word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
He can take you back to a deposit that ain't there. I ain't gonna ask you to raise your hand, but I think somebody in here knows about writing a check and ain't got no money in the bank. Hello? And one thing, if you write it and give it to somebody, you sure do have trust and confidence. Now look here, cash it on Friday. Now, there's going to be some money in the bank. Hello? Yeah. You hope that they don't go today. They tell you, shoot, I'm in the tight. I need some money right now. Yeah, okay. You're going to pay a penalty on top of what's supposed to come out. Y'all still ain't catching what I'm saying. When the word of God is in your life and mine, we have his word to draw from. But if you ain't reading your Bible, if you're not studying the word of God like you need to, how do you expect to draw from when you ain't got nothing to draw on? Ain't nothing there.
No.
Mm-hmm. Making any sense? Yeah. Making a whole lot of sense. Because of their relationship with Christ, they've got ability to overcome evil. Now, That ain't us on our own, class. No. No. He ain't under your foot. Hello? You ain't rebuking him, so hush. Okay? You ain't sending him away. If you stand firm against him, he cannot stand firm when you've got firm footing of the word of God.
Yes.
But then there's verse number 15. Now John moves into a real strong area
yes.
that has impact in the life of everybody he's been writing to from verse 12 to verse 14. Every believer has to deal with what we're getting ready to walk into in these verses. Can I say to you very quickly, don't take nothing about what we're going to talk about lightly. Don't relax, because it can be very fatal. Don't make any assumptions, because he knows our weaknesses and he will capitalize on them. Now, let me say very quickly that John doesn't say these things because they aren't true. He says these things because they serve as warning.
Yeah.
I want to tell you that Satan doesn't want me or you to know what he's getting ready to say.
Yeah.
It puts him on alert. And the more we know, the more armed we are.
Yeah.
Okay? It's important. He's scheming, he's crafty. Let me get into this. Verse number 15. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Which says that you can't have a dual love relationship. Wow. You know, down in the country, we used to call that two-timing. That might be a little bit too country for some of you city slickers. But some of us know about it. Let me move it. Come on back. He says, love not the world. Well, let's be very clear what he's talking about. He ain't talking about grass, trees, atmosphere. No. He's not talking about the human world. He's talking about a spiritual system of evil that operates in the physical realm that we live in. Though they are invisible, but the reality and the responses of this unseen world, we see the manifestation of it every day.
Yes.
We see it in crime, greed,
yes,
lawlessness. Hello, everybody.
Yes.
Yeah. The that's just a few of them. He works within this sphere that he is ruler over. And he has such control that he has a way of sucking in people,
yes,
not just unsaved folk. He knows how to do a job on some saved folk.
Yeah.
Hello? It's a system of evil. He has a way of making wrong look right and right look wrong. He's a great liar. Oh yeah, he is. That's all he do is lie. You never find any truth in Satan. Hello, everybody. We get lied to on television. Yeah, every day we get lied to by commercials with subliminal messages. Hello. If you ain't careful, Satan will use them to woo and win. Oh, it ain't that bad. Okay. All right. Let me take you back. Go to Genesis chapter 3. Maybe this will help somebody. Let me begin at verse number 1 real quick. Serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, indeed, as God said. Now he's challenging God's word and God's authority. You should not eat from any tree of the garden. Listen to her response. From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die. Serpent says to her, you ain't gonna die. God knows that the day you eat from it, your eyes are gonna be open. You're gonna be just like God, knowing good from evil. It didn't stop. He lied on God to lure Eve into sin.
Yes, sir.
Hello? Yeah. And he's still doing it. Not just Eve. He's been dealing with Adam too, so I don't want the sisters to be like, well, what about Adam? Yeah, he on Adam's case too. But in this text, look at what's going on. Verse number 6. She didn't walk away. She stayed there and contemplated what he said. Hello? When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, enticement. It was delight to the eyes, involvement. And that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from the fruit of it. She ate and then she gave home, Adam, sorry. Now, you see the progression? Satan always dresses up deception in the brightest and the best looking stuff, only to take the bait or to fall into it after its sin has been committed. Ain't no going back and reversing the process. Always making it look good. He does it now.
Yes.
Yeah, he do.
Oh, yes.
All you got to do is look at these commercials. Sex sells everything from a Hershey bar to a Mack truck.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hello?
Oh, yes.
You ain't never seen no commercial to sell you something enticing with a 400-pound woman or man. Okay, I watch TV just like y'all. And the only ones that's selling anything with the world is with the young lady in it that they just brought in talking about, we don't just sell it, we stand on it. But if you look at some of the other things, even in some of the magazines, folks half dressed, drinking Cavassier. Okay, look, I don't live under a rock. And y'all don't either. Whenever you've been minding your business, going down the aisle over there at the mall, supposed to be minding your business, they got in the window. Not ugly stuff. Okay. See, I need some shopping sisters that really gonna be for real and testify. I'll tell Rap, you're right. That they ain't got no ugly clothes in the window. They got outfits like, ooh, I sure look good in that one. Yeah. Got a dress for brothers too?
Yeah.
To bring you in. And if you ain't strong enough, reeling you in.
Yes, sir.
This system, this age, this time that we live in, I believe I'd have some help. There are some people in here who can say, I have seen evil and sin get worse over time.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Amen. We seeing stuff on TV. Our mamas and daddies, if they would have come alive and watch it, they'd almost throw up. And you know what's sad is when we get so used to it that we're calloused to it. almost expect it, and then miss it when we don't see it, only to have our minds darkened by the enemy. To love the world is to give this age affections that it is not worthy to receive. Wow. Let me ask you this. Who sits on the throne of your life? Who sits on the throne of your heart? It is to let the world possess and govern us and govern our expectations to determine what we're going to chase and what's going to be important in our life. That's deep, y'all. That's real deep. And understand, this can't be true of a real believer. We're overcoming. Hello?
Yes.
But you got to remember, you can't carry some stuff with you when you're growing. Got to let it go. Got to move on. Or it didn't get a whole lot of amens right there. This is what John is saying to this category of believers. From the most spiritually immature to the most mature believer. Watch this. Nobody is off Satan's radar. Satan got his eyes on all of us. Can I share a secret with you? Be careful about saying what your weaknesses are and what gets you angry quick. I ain't saying, well, it's out there in the atmosphere. No, that ain't what I'm saying. Satan has some demon forces who work for him. How do you think? Come on, y'all. Y'all bright. Y'all real bright. Okay, think about it like this. How is somebody going to know your secret if they don't tell it? You know, you're talking to somebody and they start talking about, I didn't know that you don't like peanut butter and jelly, and you done told, you know, somebody a couple of days ago, where you get that from? Who you been talking to? Have you ever stopped to think, maybe Satan's mastery over us and in our lives, he knows our appetites.
Oh yeah,
he do. He been watching us. Sure, he knows what we like. Because he's been watching us. And you know the problem is, he's been studying us more than we've been studying him. I mean, we're in warfare, y'all. It makes no sense for the enemy to know more about me and you than we know about him. We ought to know about his tactics. He knows about our weaknesses. And then look at verse number 16. Oh, I got to move this. I think I'm doing pretty good. For all that is in the world, all that is in this age, all that is governed by the ruler of this age, hello? Watch this. None of it glorifies God. None of it is godly. I hope y'all say something. Look at what he says. He lists lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life. Look at what he says. It ain't of God. It ain't from the Father. Hello, you see it?
Yes.
But it's from the age, the times we live in.
Yes.
There are some things now we ought not have some complacent attitude about.
Yes.
Well, you know, they just going to do what they want. I don't care if they're going to do what they want. I still don't agree with it. Hello? Are y'all scared of what? I mean, have we fallen into complacency and acceptance? Don't read your lesson, please. Are we just looking at behaviors and lifestyles and conduct and all this other stuff that's going on around us and just saying, oh well, so be it. And maybe at the same time, could we not even be condoning it?
Okay.
You want to walk heavy? Let's do it. Are you condoning behaviors of your grandkids? You didn't grow up that way. You didn't grow up dressing that way. Talking that way, acting that way. What happened to what we grew up as standard? Y'all are troubling me by your silence. We had a place where we done just gave up and say, forget it. Just go ahead and, you know, run buck wild and be crazy and that it's okay. Now, I realize that many of us don't have the element of oversight and authority and control in the lives of many of our younger children. Yeah. But we ought to be influencing them when we got them for good and godliness, baby. Yes. That you need to stay away from that.
Yeah.
Young girl, you ain't ready at 13 years old to talk about a boyfriend. You can't even spell it. Okay, see, you know, maybe what I'm saying is troubling some of you because some of your silences troubles me.
Yeah.
Are we at a place where we just say, well, I ain't going to say nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then when we look at the end product,
you
see where they are going.
Yeah.
How do you remain mute mouth? And if any of them are living with you, how do you let some of that stuff even happen under your roof?
Yes.
They grow. Okay, you grown too.
Yeah.
That's your house.
Yeah.
You got every right to stand up for what's right. And if they don't like it, there's a song we used to sing, hit the road, Jack.
Yeah.
I'm being very honest. Y'all at a place where y'all scared to do the right thing now? You ought not be. Yes, sister, real quick. Sister Rhonda, did you have any?
I was thinking.
Real loud.
Society has, if money rules, and that's the biggest problem I feel.
The God of this age.
Yeah.
The influence and the impact. Look at how it has affected us.
Yeah.
How we think. How we bought into a mindset of this age. What practices do we have that say that we are mirroring and mimicking this age? You got, I mean, this ain't child's play. Yes, real quick.
Isn't this a prime example of how when God had Moses on the mountain and the children of Israel, he was looking down upon them, and he was like, look at them, how they're acting. They made idol gods. I protected them. I fed them. And I should just destroy them. Isn't that how we are again today? God is looking down upon us. They didn't let everything in the world just creep in and forgot where I brought them from.
It's a mirror. It's a mirror reflection. And worse. And worse.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And worse.
Yes.
And it's even worse when we give license to it.
Yeah.
It's worse when we put blinders up and act like it ain't there.
Yeah.
The elephant is still in the room.
Yeah.
How come you ain't put it out?
Yeah. Yeah.
The things that we hear, the things that we see, the things that are being done, and our silence condones it. Who is speaking up? We often talk about, well, Madeline O'Hare took prayer out of school. No, she didn't. We watched a movement develop. We're watching a homosexual movement develop. Raising children in perversion. Men marrying men, women marrying women. Y'all gonna say it. Because I ain't scared. And the church has gotten mute mouth about it. Sin is on the rise. And it ain't going nowhere and it ain't scared. Sin ain't scared of the church. And the devil ain't scared of Jesus. And what's even worse is when we live as sinful and wicked as unsaved folk. I want you to read the rest of this lesson when you get home. Because this ain't child's play. Let me just read these principles real quick, and I'll be done. In verse number 16, there are reasons, four reasons why we should not love the world. One, because of what it is, this age. It's unsaved. It's satanic. It's demonic. We don't love the world because of who we are. Then your mama and your daddy teach you all before you left the house. Don't forget your last name. Oh, okay. Mine did. Yeah. You know why they were saying that? Because you represent somebody. You say you're a Christian. You're saying you represent Jesus. Don't give him a bad name. This is more than just going to church, sitting on a pew on a Sunday, and walking out of a building. This is a relationship. This is lifestyle. Can you hear me now? Has being a Christian become everything that is outside of the Bible, and we just make it what we want it to be? But then, this system does stuff. Turn folks into criminals. Makes people believe what is right is wrong and what's wrong is right. I pray you've been helped.
Oh, yes.
Pray you've been challenged.
Yes.
Pray we will all look at where are we at on the spiritual growth chart. How much more room there is to grow. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for helping us. We ask it in Jesus' name.